that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the Gospel of John.
Well, good morning, church. I'm excited to get to be with you this morning and to be able to bring this message, which is actually a message that I had some notice for and had a chance to prepare for, unlike the last couple of times that I've been with you, which means that it'll probably go terribly since I actually had a number of weeks' notice and time to prepare. No, I'm just kidding. I'm delighted by our opportunity to finish out John chapter 15. You know, if you guys want to go ahead and turn there, we're going to pick up in our study this morning in verse 18, and we're going to go actually all the way through chapter 16, verse 4. So that's what we're going to be studying this morning. And immediately, as you look at this text, you might feel like this is a departure from the conversation that we've been having, because really going all the way back to chapter 13, where we started looking at that Thursday night, that Passover meal that Jesus shared with his disciples. And as we've unpacked everything that's happened in the last several chapters, the prevailing message from Jesus to his disciples has been that he loves them, that he wants to strengthen them, that he wants to encourage them for the journey that's ahead, that he wants them, when we got into chapter 15, to abide with him so that they would be prepared for what's ahead. And then this section, which again is still part of the same conversation, it all occurs on between the upper room and the garden. This section starts with, if the world hates you, and it feels, and I'm going to just warn you ahead of time that this is going to be, it's going to feel like a tough message compared to where we've been at. But I want you to know, this is not a departure from what Jesus has been saying. In fact, the reason that he is sharing this with his disciples and the reason that we have it for ourselves is because Jesus loves us. And he loves us enough to tell us the truth about what it means to follow him. And it may happen that we live in a world, and particularly in our part of the world, where people are shying away from the truth of what it means to follow Jesus, and they want to sell a version of the gospel that requires nothing, that costs nothing, and that gives everything. But I want you to hear me, church. That does not exist. There is no version of the gospel that is just promised prosperity without any sacrifice, without any persecution. And so as we get into this section of text, I want you to recognize that the reason that Jesus is sharing this with his disciples is still the same motivation. He loves them and he wants them to be prepared for the truth of what this world will do as a reaction to Christ and as a reaction to his gospel. And so let's pick up reading in John chapter 15 there in verse 18. It says, if the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own, but because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. If they kept my word, they will also keep yours. But all these things they will do to you on account of my name, because they do not know him who sent me. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not have been guilty of sin, but now they have no excuse for their sin. Whoever hates me hates my Father also. If I had not done among them the works that no one else did, they would not be guilty of sin, but now they have seen and hated both me and my Father. But the word that is written in their law must be fulfilled. They hated me without cause. But when the Helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father, he will bear witness about me. And you also will bear witness, because you have been with me from the beginning. I have said all these things to you to keep you from falling away. They will put you out of the synagogues. Indeed, the hour is coming that whoever kills you will think he is offering service to God, and they will do these things because they have not known the Father nor me. But I have said these things to you, that when their hour comes, you may remember that I told it to you. Let's pray. Lord, we need you this morning, Lord, to come into this place and through your Holy Spirit, Lord, to open our eyes, Lord, to see the truth of your word and to open our ears, Lord, to hear from you. God, apart from you, we can do nothing. So indwell this place, Lord. Stir in our hearts, Lord. Give us the ability to hear from you, Lord, that we might recognize the truths that Christ spoke these 2,000 years ago. Lord, not that we would be afraid, not that we would, Lord, be anxious, Lord, about what's coming, but Lord, that we would know the truth of what it means to follow Christ, and Lord, that we would count the cost and decide that it is worth it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we begin to look at this text, the first thing I want you to see is the plainest thing that there is here, what Jesus starts with. He says, if the world hates you. I want you to know that this isn't an if. This is a when. When the world hates you. The thing that you should know as we dig into this is that the world will hate you when you decide to follow Christ. Man, I don't know if there's been any evangelistic sermons that have started that way, but you know, maybe somewhere nobody decided to follow. But that's the truth. That is the truth of what it means to follow Christ, is that we are immediately in opposition to the world. And even though this word in English says if, I really think we should read it as when. Because it's not a matter of will the world hate you if you decide to follow Christ. It is a definite. And we can understand that because we're about to look at what Jesus says from there. It really proves out that the truth is that there is no possibility except that the world will hate us. Because first, they hated Christ. That the truth of the matter is, he says, the world will hate you. Know that it has hated me first. So how is it that we would expect that in following Christ, a person who was without sin the 33 years that he walked on this earth, and yet people hated him vehemently, how is it that we would believe that we can follow him and not be hated, not be despised? He says, they hated me first, so it's only logical that they're going to hate you, my followers. And he tells us why. He says, they hated me first, and then he goes on and he says, if you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you were not of the world, because I chose you out of the world, therefore, the world hates you. You see, the reason he gives us, and this is the reason that we can be certain that if we're following Christ in word and in deed, that the world will hate us, is because we're immediately going to look different than the world that's around us, right? He says, you are not of the world anymore. You're no longer part of the world because I have chosen you out of the world. Well, that immediately puts us in opposition to the systems of this world. And that's really what that word world means. It really means the systems of government and of authority, of life. And I don't mean just, you know, national governments. I mean the governing system that is governed by Satan. That's what the Bible testifies to, is that he is the Lord of this world, the prince of the power of the air, the one who is presently at work in the sons of disobedience. That is our world that we currently inhabit. And yet, if we're a follower of Christ, he's purchased us out of that world and also left us here. And so there is immediately a difference between the Christ follower and the world that is around them, and that causes tension. Now, what does this hatred look like becomes the question, right? Because you guys are probably, some of you may be thinking, well, I don't know that I've experienced necessarily what I would call hatred or what Jesus is about to go on to say, people will put you to death and think that they're doing a favor to God. Like, I don't know that I've experienced that, even though we know that believers all over the world are experiencing that exact type of persecution. But the truth of the matter is, while the specifics differ, whether a specific person has expressed specific hatred to you for your following of Christ, the system of the world, right? And this is what Jesus is saying, the system of the world, all of its desires, everything that keeps the world enslaved is opposed to what it means to follow Christ. And it hates it. It hates the freedom that we enjoy in Christ. It hates righteousness. It hates victory over sin. It hates love. It hates forgiveness. None of those, if we just think about it for a second, we would recognize that none of those values are esteemed in our world. And so it only makes sense that as we follow Christ and we obey his commands, that's what he's been talking about back in the earlier part of chapter 15, that that's going to make us different from the world that he's purchased us out of, and it's going to cause it to hate us. They hated Christ first. We're not of this world. We've been chosen out of this world. And I think that, you know, he goes on there in verse 19 and says that, I chose you out of this world, and therefore the world hates you. Well, the truth of the matter is that the life change that is demonstrated in a redeemed person who is no longer who they used to be is condemning. That's really the truth of it. It's condemning to an unredeemed world, to a world who looks at their life and their choices and they go, well, what's special about you? Well, the truth of the matter is that there's nothing special about me. I just have a Savior who has paid the price, and I've yielded my life to him, and he's transformed me from the inside out and changed all of my desires. And he's made me into a new creation, and then he sent me out as an ambassador to a world who is dying. And by the way, that's all of you too, if you're Christ followers. And that looks different to a world who is living in being unredeemed. And it causes animosity, and it causes hatred. So the world will hate you. I'm sorry that that's tough news, but it's the truth. The more that we live out our faith in Christ, and hear me, church, I don't even mean speaking the name of Jesus, although we're going to get into that because that's part of our command, but I mean living in legitimately a righteous way. It is offensive to the world that is around us. So the world will hate you. I want you to look down, and next we're going to see the results of their hatred. It shouldn't be a surprise to us that the world hates us, and it shouldn't also be a surprise to us that they act on their hatred. And so let's look at what Jesus says is the result of their hatred. In verse 20, he says, remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will also keep yours. We should not expect a different fate than Christ. That's why he says, a servant is not greater than the master. And in fact, he's actually referring to just a chapter ago where he said exactly the same thing. And so, and really, in their time, right, we said all of this is recorded over a few hours. He's only talking about something he told them a few hours ago. So when he says remember, I'm not sure that he's saying, hey, think back long in your memory and remember that I said to you a servant is greater than his master. This Greek word actually can mean also keep remembering. Keep on thinking about this truth. Keep meditating on it. A servant is not greater than his master. So why is it that we should expect different treatment than Christ? I mean, I already said it. He was He was perfect. He never sinned against a single person, and yet they drug him before the authorities and put him to death. Why is it that we would expect different treatment following Christ? Why is it that we would expect that those wouldn't be the things that would also happen to us? He says, a servant is not greater than his master. Remember that. Meditate on that. Keep thinking on that so that when these things happen to you, you recognize that the persecution I am receiving is because of my master. It's because of him whom I'm following. And be comforted in that. And we shouldn't expect a different fate than Christ. We should expect to be persecuted. If they persecuted him, then they will persecute us. You know, in our world, we look at persecution as a cause for alarm. Like when something like that happens, all of the alarm bells go off, and we start going, okay, this is like we need to pray about this. We need to do something. And maybe all of those things are true, but I would submit to you that the cause for the alarm, according to the Bible, is a lack of persecution. In fact, alarm bells should be going off if you're thinking about your life right now and you're thinking, man, I've never had anybody treat me differently, malign me, ridicule me because of my faith. Because persecution is the expectation. Now, does it always happen in all scenarios? No, I already said that. Not every person that exists in this world is opposed vehemently to us as Christians, but the system of the world is absolutely opposed to the system of following Christ, and that is bound to show up given enough interactions. It's bound to show up in our life. And so what should really raise alarm bells for us is if we look at our lives and we think, man, I've never had anybody oppose me or malign me or try to push me to the side or openly ridicule me because of my faith in Christ. Because the truth is, we should expect that when we begin to live differently than the world, that it causes the world to react and that they're not going to like it, and different people are going to react differently. I share something with you. I don't very often quote movies or use that as examples. I actually kind of dislike when churches preach on entirely, you know, movie series is how they relate to the gospel, but I think this one is particularly appropriate. So when I was a teenager, The Matrix came out. And I'm not talking about, for you young people, I'm not talking about like the third and fourth reboot of that. I'm talking about the original Matrix. Just so we test how well this is going to be applicable. If you've seen the original Matrix, don't look around. It's okay. Just raise your hand. Okay. Most of y'all have seen it. Okay. In The Matrix, okay, just follow me for just one second. In The Matrix, the idea behind the movie is that there is a system controlling the world, The Matrix, that all of us live in an alternate reality, and that system is designed to oppress us so that it can enslave us. Does that sound like that tracks to you guys? Okay. And then, through the course of the movie, you begin to see that there are these people who have been rescued outside of the Matrix so that they now see that this is a system of enslavement, okay? Including the main character, which is Keanu Reeves, right? His name is Neo. There is a ton of underlying references to the Messiah and Christ in the movie The Matrix, if you know what you're looking for, because it really resembles our world. And so one of the things that happens throughout the movie is that you regularly see the people who are enslaved to the Matrix resisting the people that have been rescued from it. And in some ways in difficulty, in some ways in violence, but you see that the system that is designed to keep people enslaved resists people that are no longer slaves to it. And what I'm telling you is that's exactly what Jesus is talking about. That is exactly the picture of the reason that we should expect persecution, is because we live in a world that is enslaved and that is blind to their enslavement. And before you think that I'm just talking about things like drugs or alcohol that people might be addicted to, or pornography. All of these things are addictions that enslave us, but some of us are enslaved to just working 100 hours a week. Some of us are enslaved to retirement. Some of us are enslaved to that better life that we were told about the whole time that we were growing up. And so we're working towards those things. Some of us are enslaved to our relationships. Some of us are enslaved to the attention that we get from social media. The whole of our world is designed to enslave people and to keep them from asking, is there a God? What do I do with my sinfulness? How do I relate to them? And what I want you to see, and what Christ so clearly points to here, is that to be rescued from that enslavement automatically means that this world is going to persecute you. It automatically means that you challenge what they believe about what makes them happy and successful in their life and whether they're a good person or not. And that idea is difficult for people to grasp. And so we should expect to be persecuted, and alarm bells should be going off when we're not persecuted. So he says, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecute me, they will persecute you. If they kept my word, they will also keep yours. And so he also gives us, in this section, lastly, a way that we can differentiate between who is of the world and who is a follower of Christ. Because he says, if they listen to me, then they're going to listen to you. But by definition, by example, all of those who did not listen to Christ likely are not going to listen to Christ's followers. If they're not going to obey the commands of Christ, they're not going to listen to our words, they're going to oppose them. And so he gives us a way to delineate who is his by the keeping of his world, of his word. So the world will hate you, the results of their hatred. Next, I want us to look at the reason for their hatred. And he gives us that in 21 through 25. This is the largest section that we're going to look at because all of this is related. And he starts it by saying, but all these things they will do to you on account of my name. You see, they will do all of this on account of my name. People have an issue with Jesus. You can believe a lot of things about who God is, but Christ tells us really clearly here, all of these things they will do, not because you're sincere in your faith, not because you want to be righteous, not because you want to please God. All of these things they will do to you because of my name. And lots of other names don't really offend people. Can I tell you that? I don't know if you've observed that to be true, but there's lots of things that people can say that don't really offend people. You can happily be, you know, a Buddhist or a Hindu. You can quote the words of the Dalai Lama. You can quote the words of the Pope. You can quote the words of lots of people in this world, and people will be like, you know what? That's cool if you believe that. That's fine. But say that you're coming to them in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the one and only way to God the Father, and people will hate you for the name of Jesus, because the truth of the matter is what Christ has preached is exclusivity. There is no way to the Father apart from him. And what it means in the context of the people that he's speaking to, what he's been preaching, is that the people that he's talking to are sinful and they're desperately in need of forgiveness. Both of those things will stir up difficulties in people's hearts, because we tell them that, hey, I've got good news for you. That's what the gospel means. It means good news. I've got good news for you. That God sent his only son to live a perfect life for 33 years in a way that we could not do. But then he was put to death on a cross, and then on the third day he rose from the grave, and he's told us that all that we have to do is repent from our sins and believe on him and put our faith in him, and he will ensure that we stand in a righteous way before God and usher us into eternity. He takes away our guilt. He gives us His righteousness. Well, that whole conversation is built on the premise that we're guilty. And that's offensive to people. They don't want to hear, if I'm judged based on my actions, the good does not outweigh the bad. And the scale doesn't work that way anyway. Because both of those things are true. I want you to know, since you're sitting here this morning, you're going to hear it. The truth of the matter is, one, the scales don't work that way. It doesn't work that you can just do more good stuff than bad stuff. If I go out from here and I rob the gas station on the way home, I'm not going to go before the judge and be like, well, but I'm a pastor of a church and, you know, I do a lot of good things to help people. I'm about to go on a mission trip. They're not going to be like, that's a good reason to have robbed the gas station. No, I still have to pay the penalty for the thing that I have done. And God's sense of justice works the same way. God's sense of justice is that every offense to God requires a payment. And so the scales don't work that way. And then the other half of the equation is, even if they did work that way, the truth of the matter is your good does not outweigh your bad. None of us does. None of us does more good than we do bad. And so our only hope, if I've offended a righteous and perfect and holy and just God, my only hope is mercy. And He's given us the mechanism for mercy. That mercy comes in the form of His wrath that's already been poured out on Christ. But it's dependent on me recognizing that I am guilty and in need of a Savior and in need of pardon and in need of rescue. And that's an offensive message. That's a message that only Jesus proclaims. And that's why He says, when you come in My name, people are going to hate you, because you can come in lots of other names, preaching lots of things, and people aren't going to hate you. But you come preaching the depravity of man, our utter sinfulness before God, our wretchedness and our lack of ability to do anything about it, and Christ's goodness in saving us. And that's going to upset people. They have a hard time with this. And so we should not expect a different fate than Christ. We should, people have an issue with the reason for their hatred. People have an issue with Jesus. And then I want you to understand what He's saying there, because He says, all these things they will do to you on account of My name, because they do not know Him who sent Me. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not have been guilty of sin. The truth of the matter is that Jesus in His life, He spoke the truth to humanity. I don't want you to think that what Jesus is saying here is, if I'd have just stayed in heaven, then nobody would have been guilty of sin. That's not what He's saying. The Bible doesn't testify to that. The law was given so that we would be aware of our sinfulness. What He is saying is specifically about the religious leaders. Because I've come and I've told them about their sinfulness, they are more guilty. They are more guilty of being in opposition to God because I told them that they were unrighteous. Because I came and I told them the truth and I warned them that they didn't love God. You know, you want to know what the truth? The reason that we're about to see Him go to His death is, one, because it's God's sovereign plan. But for the men that orchestrated it, it's because He came to them and He said, you're not righteous. You don't love God. You love yourselves. You want to know what the truth is that He brought to them? It was that they loved themselves more than they love God. No wonder they wanted to put Him to death, because that stings. But He came proclaiming the truth, because the truth was what was necessary. And He proclaims the same truth to us. Jesus in His life, He spoke what was true about humanity. We love ourselves and we hate God, and that is the root of the issue. And He's about to explain that in further detail, because He's about to say, their issue with Jesus is actually an issue with God. He says, they don't know him who sent me. If I had not spoken to them, they would have an excuse. Verse 23, whoever hates me hates my Father also. Now, some people would say, wait a minute, I know God. I love God. I just don't need Jesus. I have a relationship with God. That's not the God that I believe in. The God that I believe in, I don't need a Savior. I just need a God. And if I long, as long as I believe in him and worship him, then I'm good. But that's not what Jesus is talking about. He says, they hate me because they hate the Father. What is he talking about? He's talking about the one true God of the Bible. The only God who is perfectly holy, perfectly just, perfectly righteous, who has over the last 6,000 years revealed himself to humanity countless times, all the way through the Old Testament, shepherding his people Israel, all the way through the New Testament and providing a Savior in Christ Jesus. There is a God, and his attributes are not flexible. And so what I find is that most of the time when people are saying, I believe in God, but I don't believe in Jesus, what they're saying is, I believe in a God that I've made. I believe in a God that reflects what I believe about who God should be. Well, that's just idolatry. You can call him God, and you can say we're talking about the same God, but the truth of the matter is you've just fashioned a God out of your own image, out of your own preferences, out of your own derelictions, and you worship that, and that God excuses your behavior, and so you have no need for Christ. Jesus says very clearly here, the reason that they hate Jesus is because they hate the actual true God, the one who created the heavens and the earth, the one who formed man from the dust, who made him in his own likeness, who established the laws of the universe that we live in and who rules over it in perfect justice and righteousness. That God is the one who exists in three persons, who sent his Son, and we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit in just a second. That God people hate because they hated his Son, who only ever came saying the things that God, I mean, that's what he said, didn't it? I haven't said anything except what God told me to say, and I haven't done anything except what he told me to do. And so the evidence of the world's hatred of God is in that God's perfect representative in the flesh, Christ Jesus, they hated. Well, it's because they hate the Father. They do not love God. That is the one true God, the God of the Bible. They love a God that they have made in their own image. So he says they hate me because they hate my Father. And then he says, if I had done among them the works that no one else did, which he is saying I did among them the works that no one else did, but if I had not done them, they would not be guilty of sin. But now they have seen and hated both me and my Father. You see, the truth of the matter is he didn't just come just speaking truth. He came and in his life he demonstrated that he can be believed. Again, this is not, they would have been guilty of any sin, but they would have been guilty of the specific sin of unbelief in the Messiah, of denying the Messiah. Jesus, in his person, in his 33 years on earth, he demonstrated and fulfilled over 300 prophecies. He did amazing miracles. He taught with authority. And we have even recorded in the Bible where his detractors are saying, who teaches this way? Who, if he goes on like this, everybody will believe in him. And yet, even the people who saw him firsthand, they continued in their unbelief. And so he's saying that the fact that I came and demonstrated all of these things for you is even more of a judgment against you. I came and I proved that I was the Messiah. I came and I proved that I was the one that you have been proclaiming that you're waiting for. for all of these millennia, and yet you did not believe. He demonstrated it. He didn't just say it. He demonstrated it, that he can be believed and that he is the Messiah. And why did all this happen? I want us to see. He says, but the word that is written, this is verse 25, in their law must be fulfilled. They hated me without cause. Now he's referencing either Psalm 35 or Psalm 69. Both of those say that exact thing. They hated me without cause. Both of them written by David. We know that David, in a lot of ways in the Old Testament, was meant to foreshadow Christ. And so he says, why did all this happen? It happened because this is God's sovereign plan. It was God's plan that despite me being clearly a messenger from God, they would hate me. This was not an accident. This was not them being stirred up in their passions against Christ, or maybe he said the wrong thing or did the wrong thing. This was evidence that they had always hated God. And it ought to put in clear terms for us how broken we are apart from Christ. Because the truth of the matter is the same thing can be said about us. The evidence is piled up against us. Just by the sheer fact that you're sitting in this room, you have heard that there is a God who loves you, but also one that you're living in opposition to. And there's also a Savior who has been sent for you, but that requires that you yield to Him. And some of you will walk out of here without ever doing that. And I would submit to you that exactly what Jesus says here is applicable to us. You've heard the truth. You've had it demonstrated for you. And yet, we refuse to believe and we refuse to submit our lives before God. So the world will hate you. The results of their hatred we looked at. The reason for their hatred we looked at. Now I want us to look at the rescue from their hatred. And you're like, okay, finally some good news. We get rescued from their hatred. Nope, that's not the rescue I'm talking about. I'm talking about their rescue from their hatred. We don't get our rescue until Christ returns and he ushers in a new heaven and a new earth, and he formulates for himself a place that is perfect and where his worship goes on day and night for eternity. That's when our rescue comes. But let me tell you when the rescue for the hating world around us comes, how it comes. He says in verse 26, but when the Helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, he will bear witness about me. And you also will bear witness because you have been with me from the beginning. You see, how does the rescue from their hatred take place? Well, it takes place when he sends the Helper. Just a few verses down, this is going to be next week's message. We're going to spend the whole time together talking about the Holy Spirit and His work. And I warned you guys, we're Baptists, but we still believe in the Holy Spirit. Just because we're not Pentecostal doesn't mean we don't believe in the Holy Spirit. We do. We need the Holy Spirit. And He's about to say, I'm going to send my Helper to you. And you know what He's going to do? He's going to convict of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Well, how does the rescue from their hatred come? Well, it comes when the Holy Spirit comes and He convicts, because that's His job. His job is to illuminate in our lives the areas where we're deficient and to cause us to turn to Christ. And so he says that there's a rescue coming from this hatred, not to rescue you, but to rescue people out of their hatred. And it's going to come when I send the Helper, when I send the Holy Spirit. He's going to convict of sin and righteousness and judgment. How is that a rescue, you might ask? Well, it's the only way to be rescued. The only way to be rescued from the hatred of God is to be convicted of our hatred of God, that we might repent from it and turn to Him. So we have a helper who's coming. He's sent from the Father. That's what Jesus says. I have a helper who comes. I will send him to you from the Father. You know what that means? That means that God's sovereign plan and his power is at work in the Holy Spirit, working in us and working in those around us. God's power, that's what we see over in the book of Acts when he says, you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes. God's power at work in people's lives is the Holy Spirit that he's sending to us. And this is good news, church, because the question, I don't know about you, but the question I have when I read a passage like this that's so full of how the world that I live in is opposed to me and is hell-bent on persecuting me, I think that's an appropriate use of the word hell-bent. Hell-bent on persecuting me. What do I do about that? Well, the truth is I rely on God because he's the one that can convict and he's the one that can speak into their lives and rescue them from their hatred. I can't rescue anybody from their hatred. I don't have the power to do that. I need his Holy Spirit that's coming, the helper, the one who is sent from the Father. But look at what he also says about him. He says he's the Spirit of truth. What do we need to rescue people from this hatred? Well, they need the truth. That's right. You're right, Gabriel. It is the truth. That's what they need. Because they've believed a lie about what this world is, about who God is, and nothing but the Spirit of truth is going to change that. Nothing but God's truth is going to speak into a world that is decidedly against God and is deceived in their thinking. He is necessary. He's a necessary agent to bring about that rescue that we are talking about. Apart from the truth, we have no hope of a rescue from our opposition to God. So he says he's the Spirit of truth. But then he also says he will bear witness about me. He will bear witness about me. He will also bear witness about sin. To bear witness about Christ is to bear witness about sin, about the need for repentance, about the available forgiveness, about God's goodness, about redemption, about life change. That's what it means to bear witness about Christ, is to bear witness that those things are necessary, and he's going to send his Spirit, the Spirit of truth, the one sent from the Father, to bear witness about those things in the hearts and lives of people who are opposed to God. But I want you to know, he doesn't just hang it all on the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the one that we absolutely need to accomplish this mission. But look at what he says. He says, and you also will do what? Bear witness. Because you have been with me from the beginning. So the Spirit is going to bear witness, but we will also bear witness to a world that needs to be rescued, that there is hope, that they don't have to continue on in their sinfulness, that they don't have to continue on in their unforgiveness, that they don't have to continue on in their hatred toward a holy God, but that they can be rescued from it. How do I know that we're going to bear witness to that? Well, that's what Acts 1:8 says. Jesus, when he had them gathered all around there, after he'd appeared to them for more than 40 days, he said to them, and you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. You are going to go and bear witness that I am who I said I am. And praise the Lord that those few men that were gathered around right there didn't take that as an optional task, because none of us would be sitting here. They went out into Jerusalem first, until they had experienced such persecution that the authorities were remarking on this. They were dragging them before the council. They were charging them strictly not to preach anymore in the name of Jesus. The Bible says that they turned the whole place upside down. And then they went out from there into Judea and into Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the world, bearing witness about this Christ that has come and provided forgiveness for sins. So the rescue from their hatred comes in the form of the helper. We desperately need God. We can't do this work apart from the Holy Spirit who is sent from the Father, who is the Spirit of truth, who bears witness to what God has done and their need for salvation. But we also are a part in that. We will bear witness along with Him. So we've looked at that the world will hate us. We've looked at the results of their hatred, the reason for their hatred, the rescue from their hatred. The last thing I want us to see this morning is the response to their hatred. And really here what I mean is our response. How ought we to respond? And I think this is particularly appropriate because maybe for some of you guys, this is the first time that you really have considered that the world that I live in is opposed to my Christian faith. And that to live it out means that I'm going to be persecuted from the world around them. And I want you to know that he says all of this, everything that we've already looked at, he says all of this in love to prepare them. How do I know that? Well, that's how he starts the next verse. I've said all of these things to you to keep you from falling away. He says, the reason I've warned you of this is to keep you from, when this thing happens, being surprised by it and falling away. And we talked about it a number of weeks ago. I think that's the same reason that he tells Peter of his coming denial, is so that when it happens, Peter doesn't run and cry, but he becomes resolute. He recognizes Jesus saw this coming. He's not caught off guard. When you experience persecution for your faith in Christ, don't be caught off guard. Jesus isn't. He knew it was coming and he warned you. He tells you to keep you from falling away so that we should remain steadfast. He says, I told you this to keep you from falling away. He doesn't want us to be distracted, dismayed, or discouraged when these things happen because we are prepared, because we're expecting it. We should expect persecution. In this verse 2, he says, they will put you out of the synagogues. Indeed, an hour is coming when whoever kills you will think he is offering a sacrifice to God. We should expect persecution, to be put out of the synagogue for Jesus' disciples, his Jewish followers, would be to be an outcast from their own people, their own religious leaders. To constantly have people telling you that what you believe about this Jesus is not true. I mean, that's what he's saying, is that from now on, people are constantly going to tell you that this is not right. And then they're going to ostracize you from your own people, from your own synagogues, the center of Jewish life in a town. And they're going to push you out of them, and you should expect that. So we should remain steadfast, we should expect persecution, and we should not be surprised when people celebrate our death. That's what he says. But I would say also we shouldn't be surprised when people celebrate our failures, our misfortunes. And this is perhaps one of the most alarming statements in this passage. But the truth about who Jesus is and what he came to do is so polarizing that some people will even think that they are doing something honorable for God when they resist us. And we need to expect that. Now, should that mean that we respond in kind? No. No, when we expect it and when we're prepared for it, we know that the reason that people will do these things, and if you don't believe it, just read anything about any major personality in the U.S. who has had any moral failure that is a pastor or leader of a church, and people love to celebrate that. I mean, they love to just blow it up and look, go, here, look, you can't trust any of these Christians because look at what they're leaders do. They will celebrate our demise. But we don't respond in kind. We prepare ourselves. We recognize that this isn't them talking. This is the world that they are a part of that is opposed to God and His goodness and the need for righteousness and the need for forgiveness and the need for salvation. And that is what motivates them to respond in the way that they do. And if we're prepared for that, then we can respond correctly, assured in our faith, confident in what Christ has called us to do, steadfast in the midst of persecution. And that's the last thing as the band comes that I want you to see there in verse 4. But I have said these things to you that when their hour comes, you may remember them that I told them to you. I told you all of this, everything that we've been through this morning, difficult as it is. And Jesus says, I told you this so that when these things happen, you will remember them and will be strengthened, will be encouraged, will be confident. You know, that's, I think, maybe is the best word, is confident. Because when these things happen, I can know that my Savior was right. I can know that He saw it all. I can know that He didn't hold back from telling me something that was difficult, but instead He told me the truth. And so that when it happens, I can be confident that He is who He says He is, and that He's in control. And church, that's good news. That's good news. I know it doesn't feel like it in a message about the whole world is going to hate you, but it's full of good news. Because we have a Savior who loves us, who has bought us out of this world, who has redeemed us at such a price. And there is a victory that is certain. I told you, our rescue doesn't come now. Now, that doesn't mean He might not. That doesn't mean that He might not deliver you from a persecution that you're going through right now here on earth, but that is not guaranteed. We are guaranteed persecution as followers of Christ, and we are guaranteed that He is ultimately victorious. We are guaranteed. He said already, right? I go to prepare a place for you. If it wasn't so, I wouldn't have told you that. We are guaranteed eternity, but right now, in the here and now, we have to recognize the truth of the world that we live in, and we have to be ready to go out into it with truth. And that's going to mean persecution. As we move into this time of invitation, I want you to take a moment and just examine how the Lord has been speaking to you. Are there areas in your life where maybe we haven't gone out with the truth of the gospel? Maybe we're not experiencing, and none of us should long for persecution. The goal is not to be persecuted. It's just to recognize that persecution is evidence of the truth in my life that opposes the world around me. Maybe there's areas where God is convicting you, a coworker that you need to share with, a neighbor. I'm going to give you this time to pray for them. Now, as of this moment, we've had over 900 people share the gospel so far this summer. It's in the lobby. You can check it out on the way by. But keep praying for those people. Keep sharing. And if you need Christ, I'm going to be here. I'm going to be right here for anybody that needs to put their faith and trust in Christ. You've heard the gospel as clearly as I know how to present it this morning. If you recognize that you're a sinner, if you recognize that apart from Christ, you have no hope, He stands ready to receive you. This time is for you. Would you pray and respond? Church, the band is going to sing, and I will be here to pray with you if you need Christ. Pray, church.